while the contestants are competing. There will be an opportunity to take pictures with later on during the event with each contestant and the winner. Contestants, timers, ballot counters, and sergeant of arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of this contest. Everyone is aware of Toastmasters international rules that govern this contest. I think that it's duly right that I will give you a reminder for the audience. The contestants will have 2 minutes to deliver their speech and their response to the table topic question. Contestants who speak less than 1 minute or more than 2 minutes, 30 seconds, will be disqualified. Timing will begin with the first definite verbal or nonverbal communication with the audience. The timers will show a green card at 1 minute, yellow card at 1 minute, 30 seconds, and a red card at 2 minutes. The red card will remain raised until the contestant finishes speaking. There will be no indication of running past time. The sergeant of arms will escort all the contestants except for the first from the room. During the minute of silence, the sergeant of arms will escort the next speaker into the room. One, a contestant has spoken, he or she may remain in the room. Again, no one should enter or leave the room during the contestant's presentation. You may do so if time permits during the minute of silence between the presentations. I would now like to give you the speaking order.
Yeah.
are ready to hear from our tabletop contestant. Tabletop contestant number one.
Damn.
Mr. L. Darnell Good. Elder Nell Williams, if happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? If happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? L. Darnell Williams.
Say good morning to fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries, guests. If happiness was the currency, what I would do is supply everybody with as much of it as I could. And how I would do that is I would simply have it installed in them at birth. So that everybody would be happy all the time. That would be exciting, wouldn't it? If everybody was happy all the time, people would smile every day, they would shake hands and hug and do everything that we needed. There would be no wars. There would be no shootings as we have in the city of Chicago. Everybody would just be happy. And it would just really put everything in perspective for everyone. Because you could spend as much of it as you wanted to. On everybody. How much happiness do you have? You know? How much happiness do you have? I got a lot of happiness. It's the currency of the world. Everybody has a lot of it because we were installed with it at birth. And as you grow older, you will be able to grow in your happiness because of the amount of happiness you share with others. Making everybody simply a life winner because they're happy. And I would walk around and I would tell people, that's why I'm happy. This is a toast table, man.
Chief Timer, may we please have 1 minute. Topic contestant number two, Dale Obrokta. If happiness were the national currency, What kind of work would you do that would make you rich? If happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? Mr. Dale O'Brien.
It's always been a currency. We go back to the beginning of time. You just smiled at somebody. And they may have given you a phone number. They may have helped you with your car. It's nothing new. It's been around since man was created. That smile is what brings us together as people. I could be fearing for my life, and if I smile, they may give me that extra second. To flee, to run, to look him in the eye and say, here's my phone, take it, it's a work phone. Smiles are nothing new. What do we say? Sit upside down and it's a frown? Smiles are powerful. It's been a currency that we use for decades. So this notion that it's only new because we don't think of it as currency. But I know my child works that smile. He knows the currency. Everybody understands the currency of what a smile can do for you. I just feel sorry for those people who don't understand the currency of a smile, cannot give a smile. So I'd like you to think about this when you leave this room. You have the currency in your pocket. Please use it. It's a smile. Mr. Pendleton.
Sergeant O'Brien has reminded us, let us all silence our cell phones and any other electronic devices. Washington.
everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you, contest Toastmaster, dignitaries, friends, and fellow Toastmasters. If happiness was a currency, what would I do to make myself rich? That's a question we all ask ourselves. If there were no restrictions, how would we handle what it is that we do? Happiness is the thing that is so deep and rich in our souls. We would be lost if we didn't have it to tap into on occasion. I would take the strings of happiness and every little child I would meet along the way. We would play jump rope with the strings of happiness. We would fly kites with the strings of happiness. We would sit down and play in the dirt and make strings of happiness. And their laughter would be the richness that I would receive. The laughter of the children is what would take me to the next level of existence. And my friends, imagine the difference of the temper in the world if we took the strings of happiness and we put it inside of us. And every time we met a child along the way, we would pull it out, give them a little piece of string, and away they would go to share with someone else. My. Imagine holding happiness in your hand. Imagine having untold wealth to share with someone else along the way. And I thank you.
What kind of work would you do that would make you rich? Renee Parker.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Mr. Table Topics. Toastmaster. Welcome, distinguished guests and friends. Happiness was the national currency. What type of work would I do? Well, one of the things that I currently do and enjoy is mentoring. Because I believe that everyone, when they achieve their highest potential, they find happiness. Because it's the work that they were meant to do when they came here on this earth. That's what I believe. So, if you're doing the thing that you enjoy, then you'll find happiness. And that's free, right?
Yeah.
So, when I go about my day, I mentor people
just by smiling and changing their mood. That's a way of showing people that you can change right where you are by giving a smile. And I think that's the way we started out today, right? Smiling. And that's a form of mentoring your life and showing your life to the world. That's a gift, currency. We all have that gift to give to someone else and show them that they can be happy no matter their circumstances. And that's the one thing that I've always admired about people, is that no matter what their circumstances, they come up, they rise above, and they achieve. So that's why I enjoy mentoring people. And that's what my national currency would be. Mentoring people, helping them to be happy.
Contestant number 5, Clarence Banks. If happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? If happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich?
Contest chair in the terms of Toastmasters, fellow contestants, and guests. If happiness was a national currency, what kind of work would I do to make it rich? Give it all away. Give it. Give, give, give. The more you give, the more you receive. Why would I want to keep all that happiness? What did the contest chair say this morning? Smile. Put a smile on your face. Give it away. Give away that happiness. Currency. Currency is happiness. Why would you want to maintain it? Keep it to yourself. Don't be selfish. Let's share. Share that happiness. Share the love. That's what it's all about. It's really about giving, isn't it? Why would you want to keep what you can share and make other people happy? So, the question is, if happiness was the national currency, what would you do to be rich? What's the contest show?
Please one minute. international currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? If happiness were the national currency, what kind of work would you do that would make you rich? James Trader.
How many of you in here would like to be rich? By show of hands. Mr. Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters, and future Toastmasters. Imagine this. You have this gold mine, and everything that constantly turns out currency to make you rich. This currency is happiness. I would give it to the world. Because a happy world would be a peaceful world. Think about this. When you are happy, truly happy, do you really concern yourself with your problems, the negative things that go on in life? No, I don't think so. You focus on happiness. You have the sun shining on you. Everything is good. So that was what I would look for. I want to share my wealth of happiness with the entire world, not just with myself. Because guess what? If I make you happy, I'm happy. And happiness to me is one of the most important things you can have. That's the true wealth, happiness. Because when you're happy, it means you have good health. Everything comes down to happiness. And if you're able to share that, that will make us all better people. That's my goal in life, share that happiness with the entire world. Mr. Contest.
In the corporate world. And one of the things that I focus on the most is communication. If we can bridge the gap we have in our communication styles, happiness amongst everyone is the end result. There are a few key things that we need to be able to do in our world, in our society, to increase that happiness and build that communication gap. One is being open and respectful of other people's thoughts and ideas and where they come from. Really getting an understanding and empathizing with other people in order to build up that trust and understanding with each other. The second thing that we really need to focus on if we want to bridge those communication gaps is being able to articulate our point of view and how we feel in a respectful way. By empathizing with someone else and then saying, I understand where you come from, now please let me help you understand where I'm coming from. You see, communication is why we're all here, isn't it? Because we want to better communicate with each other and with other people and get our ideas across in a way that will make people take notice. So if happiness were the national currency, I think I'd be swimming in money because I am very happy doing what I do, and I hope that I bring happiness to those that I support and serve in the work that I do. Mr. Contest.
Mr. Toastmaster, we have all the ballots.
Make me think about Dana Lamont and Toastmasters. Are you familiar with him? He's a judge.
Wow.
So that happiness brought some growth to me.
Oh,
as well.
Oh.
How long you been a Toastmaster?
I just turned
1 year as a Toastmaster. Wow.
It says that your interest is encouraging people to be life winners, to explore their, quote, real vision, end quote. Could you explain that?
I really like to raise people's awareness level. You know, and as a blind guy, we have to be aware of everything at all times. And what I found, now don't shoot the messenger. Most people that can see have a low awareness level. Not my fault, it's not your fault. It's just the way it is. So once you find your real vision, you really can see yourself truly from inside out.
Wow. All right.
Well, Mr. L. Darnell Williams, I appreciate you being a contestant. Congratulations on participation in the speech contest. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Dale O'Brockta, I love seeing your name because I do think of Brock Candy. It paints the correct picture to me. And your favorite quote is, if a picture represents 1,000 words, a facial expression equals a couple hundred? Okay, explain.
On Toastmasters, we spend hours and hours and hours crafting a message. And we look for that specific word. Mm. When we realize that actually a pause, a smile, can actually say a lot more. And what we do is we forget about our other skills. Just smiling, facial expressions, moving. And that's all communication. And as Toastmasters, we're focusing on communication, but we get so wrapped up on the spoken word that we forget that simple smile can actually convey a lot more. And if you look at a child, they convey a message every time they talk to us, and they may not say a word. So that's what I feel about that message.
All right, thank you for that. Thank you. Thank you. I've heard what inspires you most is a good peach cobbler. Did you bring some?
I tried to apologize.
Oh. You just followed that. Cowboy Pass, old Western movie.
Yes.
Hmm. Which one?
Just pick one. Okay, Corral.
Okay. Okay. I love that one. What's the cowboy pass?
Okay, very simply, imagine if you were coming from the West and the other cowboy was coming from the East, eventually your paths will cross, and at the intersection of that passing, you're moving into the other direction. And so you say to your friend, I'll meet you at the cowboy pass. That just simply says, we'll gather there together and then decide from there where we will go. And so that's what we all did today. Everybody came from a specific location. We met up at the college, and when it's all over, we're going to go in the other direction. So we will have met at the pass, which is the college, and then we wave bye-bye as we're galloping away.
Ms. Harlette Washington, may I ask one question? don't go back. Will that be a
problem? Yes, it will be. And I hope you guys can hear me okay. I am so hoarse, I tell you.
I want to thank you for your participation. Miss Renee Hartman. An interest of yours is fitness and mentoring. I mean, I would be a fitness. Are you a coach?
I actually, last year, got a certification in STEM, in cycling. Ooh. So I was able to teach cycling, which was a lot of fun, a lot of work, on a bike that's called Wheel Route. This bike, even though it's stationary, it turns. Mm. This way and that way, and it's over 200 pounds. Ooh, wow. So you build upper body and core strength. Mm-hmm. And that was a lot of fun. And the key to staying with it is.
Now, I saw you stay with this on this bike. Yeah. They actually had a song. Do you know what that was called? No. The Twix. Once I get done doing tennis, I'll meet you at the house. like to sing?
I do, very much so. Well, I've been singing probably since I could talk, and there was a period of time that I was actually in a band, and I say we were a cover band and did a lot of rock tunes, and I was the lead singer of Angela's Pants. Now it's just occasionally karaoke.
You sang at the old career, right? You have done some home improvements?
Oh yeah. I bought my house almost 13 years ago and just love getting my hands dirty and going in there. We ripped out the baseboards to put in new baseboards. I built patios in the backyard with my own two hands. By the way, if you're ever going to build your own brick patio, go smaller than 16-inch bricks. They weigh a lot more than you think. And I'm quite certain that our fitness coach would love all the squats that I was doing. Yeah, it's a lot of work. So a lot of, you know, try to do it myself if I can. I don't do plumbing or major electrical.
I mean, I did try to do some electrical. I need a shot for myself. Maybe that's why my brain is fried. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to sing my way back to happiness. Save big money at Menards. Truly an honor and a privilege to be your Toastmaster this evening. And as I depart, I want to call up while the ballots are still being collected our program quality director, Cassandra Lee, for some announcements. Miss Cassandra.
Would like to exchange this speaking space with our district director, Mr. Ivory Flynn.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
Happy! I was just hearing that song in my head. Just be I just forgot a little bit. But I want some information to get across to you. And I'm looking for Bill Morrell and Tiffany Howard. Are they in?
Tiffany is on her way.
Okay, well, I'll tell you. What is important right about now? Right about now, we need you to do one thing. And April 1st. What is do April 1st? That's right. We need everybody to pay dues. And since Tiffany just walk through the door, she can come and tell you why we need you to pay dues.
Can we pay with happiness?
Like table topics all over again. I was looking for my counterpart, Bill, but I will take the reins to do it myself. So right now we are upon dues renewal. Nyva did a great job with the lead-in. But the main purpose is, who likes Toastmasters? Is that why we're here today? We like our memberships, right?
Yes!
So we don't want them to lapse. So come April 1st, there isn't that grace period that we've all known and loved for years past. It's not. So as of April 1st, if you don't pay your membership, you're no longer a member, and we want you to keep coming back for more. So you need to make sure and get your membership paid, but also your clubs need to have a minimum of 8 members paid to be a good standing club. So anyone that's competing today, if you're going to go on to that next level, your club has to have a minimum of 8 members, as well as yourself renewed, or you're disqualified, and we don't want that to happen. And also, for conference, so if you want to come to conference, you need to be a member in good standing as well. So we hope that everybody pays their dues and keeps coming back, because I love all the smiling faces in the room today, and I welcome you to the next event. Thank you.
You did a great job explaining that. Now, to explain about the spring conference, Cassandra Lee.
As Program Quality Director, there are so many announcements that I have to make, and spring conference tends to be one of those. I want to mention to you, several of you received as a thank you for supporting our area speech contest, the special QQD report, Program Quality Director report that showed how your clubs are doing. A lot of that information influences you at the spring conference because we will have the Achievers reception on Friday night. If you are still working toward an award and you have not yet gotten that into the TI system, please make certain that the date is by March 31st, so that way you can receive an invitation to the Achievers Award reception. As I said, that'll be Friday night. Also, as Program Quality Director, because the Spring Conference is upon us, we are doing some very cool, different activities at the Spring Conference this year. We will have a business briefing on Friday night. We will have two district business meetings on Saturday afternoon. Why are we doing two district business meetings?
Because two are more fun.
Yeah, because right, we have two districts, so we'll be splitting from District 30 into District 103, and all of that business is being taken care of on Saturday. Saturday will give us an opportunity to have educational sessions, which those are fresh off the presses. Final edits were made last night. We will be getting that information on our spring conference website this weekend, so that way you will know. As a matter of fact, why don't I go ahead and give those individuals an opportunity who know for sure that they will be presenting at the spring conference, who are physically present in this room, to just simply stand.
Here, 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 here.
To find it out. Sharon Giles, Frank Hesser, both distinguished Toastmasters will be presenting. You will be able to find out what they're presenting, what time they're presenting, and all of that at the Spring Conference website. As a matter of fact, do you have your program in front of you or something to write on? I want to make certain that I give you that Spring Conference website. I see our D30 website listed, but I want to make certain that I give you the special website for the Spring Conference. And by the way, if you haven't already picked up the Spring Conference flyer, make sure to grab a few of these for your club as well. Now, here's the special website to go to. Jot down http://newlegacy.d30toastmasters. Bless you. Right on cue for .org. Again, that's http://newlegacy.d30toastmasters.org. There is a link on that site for the registration to register your clubs, because all clubs are now able to register for the early bird price before March 31st. There will also be information on that website about all of the speakers, their programs, their titles, and information also about the newly released video banner parade. This year, instead of having clubs march down the walkway with their banner, what we're actually going to give you an opportunity to do is to create a photo of you and your members holding your club banner wherever you would like to be. And once you make that submission, it's going to be provided or put into a video presentation. So that means we will have a video loop playing of all clubs participating in a video banner, or as we're calling it, the virtual banner parade. Now here's the one caveat. Your club must be using the newly branded Toastmasters International banner. So that means if you have a banner with the old logo and the old colors, that will disqualify you from participating. But we don't want that to happen, because you still have enough time to update your banner and to get that in the new branded logo with the new branded colors so you can participate. Details are on the table out in the hallway. Feel free to take one of these flyers. It'll provide you with all the specifics as well as where you're emailing your photo. As I look through my notes and what I have in my hand regarding spring conference, those are, for the most part, the key points. As I said, this flyer is out there, tons of them. Feel free to take a few so you can pass them out at your club. We are registering clubs right now, so feel free to go out to newlegacy.b30toastmasters.org to get your clubs and your members registered. Mr. District Director.
The celebration. We're going to celebrate the last celebration of District 30 Chicagoland. We have some nice little gifts for you.
Commemorative gifts.
Yes, commemorative gifts. Yeah.
Agreed.
We're working on it. We haven't priced. Got it down. Tiff is working on that. Excuse me. And little things to help you remember the old way we were. You know, just think, you can take it home and put it up and remember. Because when this is all over, what are you going to be? What are you guys going to be?
D103!
D103! That's right. And so, you got to start a new legacy. That's why we're doing this. Because you got to remember your new number. So when somebody asks you, what district are you in? You'll be District 30. It's going to be D103. It's going to be proud about it. We're going to take a 10-minute break. And come back in 10 minutes.
Everybody got a raffle ticket?
No.
Right. Who doesn't?
Raise your hand if you don't have a raffle ticket.
And somebody will be around to give you one. It won't be me, but I will. You can take over, Jerome. I got the attention. Who else?
We're getting ready to start the second contest. Keep your hands on the most who need a raffle ticket. The raffle will be, of course, held after our
segment
today.
Thank you,
sir. Let me just go ahead and let
I was late getting here.
Tell you when, and Frank, you can take note when you're ready. Essentially, the next half is going to be hyper acute of the first half. It's like Jill says, the international contestants will not be standing outside in the wings like this. They will be in the room. So we will call their names individually. The speaking order will be given to you momentarily by our contest master, Frank Kesser. I don't have the bill. I do have the bill. So I'm going to give it to you now. Thank you, final preparation. Get your programs out, and so I'll give you the speaking order.
That's for my crew.
Number one is Matthew Walsh. They're listed in alphabetical order by last name. Number two is James Hammonds. Contestant number three is Sean McPartland. Contestant number four is Bridget Small. Contestant number five is Andrea Kowalski. Contestant number six is Yvonne Bailey. And contestant number seven is Bessie Akwamwa. So what we will be doing is we will be announcing their name. We will be giving the title of their speech twice, and then we will be saying their name again, and that will be your huge applause as they come up. So hold your applause for the first time, as we want to make sure that their title is clear, and then after the second time that we repeat the title, we'll say their name a second time. That will be your cue to let loose on your applause.
Okay.
So, yes.
Just a brief announcement.
Yes, about the video program.
A link will be made available to our division director probably within hours after the contest, or you can email me directly. Public release at the conference. Anybody who's opting out, please see me so I can make sure you're out before I do anything.
That's right. In case any of the contestants are in the witness protection program. A voluntary thing, and if they want to opt out, they can contact this gentleman who's doing the video.
I will also give an email address to our division director so you can access me directly and I can give you access.
Great. Not that I'm planning our contestant would be the call you on it. As an example. So, and now I'd like to introduce the person who is going to be guiding us through the international waters of our next contest. That is our director of seven, Frank Hester.
Thank you, fellow Toastmasters, all of you wonderful contestants, and a special warm welcome to any guests in the room. We've already been given the speaking order. I want to do a very important reminder. It's very important to me because I was one of the dummies whose phone went off. I have bad fingers. And when I hit my button and I had a choice between to power off or to reboot my phone, apparently I must have hit reboot, stuck it in my pocket, and then my phone goes off and I'm like, who's the idiot that's
got
a right there, right? So earlier we had a Toastmaster that said, I'm a cream puff, and I'm the Toastmaster who is the idiot. Please. Make sure that you hit power off and not reboot. Once the contest has begun, the sergeant-at-arms will secure the doors. Members of the audience are again asked to refrain from leaving or entering the room during the contest. After the contest, please do not leave the room until it has been announced that all of the ballots have been collected. As a reminder to all, the contestants have 5 to 7 minutes to deliver a substantially original speech. Contestants who speak less than 4 minutes, 30 seconds, or contestants who speak for more than 7 minutes, 30 seconds, are disqualified. Time will begin with the first definite verbal or nonverbal communication. The timers will show a green card at 5 minutes, a yellow card at 6 minutes, and a red card at 7 minutes. The red card will remain up until the contestant finishes speaking. There will be no indication of running past time. I want to remind everybody that the contestants, timers, ballot counters, and sergeant-at-arms have all been briefed prior to the beginning of this contest. Everyone is aware of the Toastmasters International rules that govern this contest. Again, no one should enter or leave the room during the contestants' presentation. You may do so, if time permits, during the 1 minute of silence between presentations. With that said, let the contest begin! Thank you. What I will do is I will announce each contestant's name, followed by their speech title. I will pause briefly, and then once again, I will announce their speech title, and then the contestant's name. Our first contestant this afternoon, actually still morning, our first contestant today is Matthew Walsh with his speech, Thank You, Sue. Thank you, Sue, Matt Walsh.
Thank
Dr. Martin Luther King once said, it's always the right time to do the right thing. I'm sure we all agree with that sentiment, but we don't always practice it now, do we? Especially when doing the right thing requires us to confront someone, to have a difficult conversation with them, or tell them something that they don't want to hear. We fear that we'll be embarrassed by bringing it up, or worse, that we'll embarrass the other person or even make them angry. So we delay. We put things off. We say, we'll get to it later, and we never solve the problem. Mr. Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters and guests, if I could be so bold as to amend Dr. King's words just a little bit, I would say now is the right time to do the right thing. Don't fear embarrassment. Don't even fear anger. Because if you know you're doing the right thing, then you should also know that you're doing a favor for that person. And someday, they'll thank you. Now, I know this to be true from personal experience. The year was 1974. It was the summer between my 7th and 8th grade years of grammar school. And during that summer, I had made an amazing discovery. Girls! Girls! They've been around me my entire life, but all of a sudden, they just seem so fascinating! One day, I was walking down the street and I ran into a friend from school. And while we talked, he told me that a group of 6 girls from my class were planning a trip out to Yorktown Mall in a few days. They're going to meet at a bus stop not far from my house, take the bus out there, and, you know, do what kids do at a mall, hang out, have fun. What's more, my friend and 3 other boys had heard about this trip, and they were going along too. This sounded like a pretty good day to me. So I invited myself to be part of the group. Now, I didn't take this decision lightly. You see, back in 1974, I wasn't the suave, sophisticated Romeo that stands in front of you this evening. No, back then, this required careful planning. I had to make sure that my best bell-bottom blue jeans were clean and ready to go. I went to my closet and went through it and checked out shirt after shirt after shirt, trying to find one that was so cool that I looked great, but not so cool that everyone knew I'd spent hours in front of the closet trying to find a cool shirt. I practiced conversation topics that made me seem sophisticated and worldly, and I even practiced a couple of jokes that in case my natural humor somehow failed me. Well, the big day came. I put on those bell-bottom blue jeans, that cool but not too cool shirt. I combed my hair, yes, I had hair. I combed my hair, it was just right, and I looked at myself in the mirror and I said, Matt, you look great. Let's go. And I headed off to my first adventure in this exciting new world. When I got to the bus stop, I saw 6 girls from my class. I walked up and I said, hey guys, ready to go to the mall? And then I noticed there were no other boys. I said, so, where are the guys? You know, and they informed me that the day before, all 4 of the other boys had backed out. Oh, is right. This changed everything. But what could I do? I was clearly there to go to the mall with the girls. I had shown enthusiasm for going just a second earlier. And what's more, I couldn't think of a safe way to back out without looking foolish. So I stayed. A few minutes later, I was down the sidewalk a little bit, trying to catch a glimpse of the bus as it came down the street, when Sue Schallenberger walked up to me. Sue was a nice girl in the class. Everyone got along with Sue. So when she said, Matt, can I talk to you for a second? I said, sure, Sue, what's up? And then Sue said, Matt, none of the girls want you to go with us today. Do you know the term crestfallen?
Yes. Yes.
It describes that feeling of, like, collapse that you feel when something you wanted, something you desired, something you dreamed about is snatched away. Well, I was crestfallen. My dreams, my anticipations, my expectations for that day had been collapsed right in front of me brief minutes after they started. I stammered out something like, all right. And then Sue went back and stood with the girls. I waited a few seconds, and then I walked up to the group and I said, you know what, you guys go have a good time. I decided I'm going to change my mind. I'll see you later, and I headed back home. On the way, I must admit, I got angry.
and I took out my anger on poor Sue Schallenberger. I remember thinking, who is she to talk to me like that? How could she be so mean to me? What kind of person would say that? And then I answered my own questions. Who does she think she is? She thinks she's your friend, man, because she just did you a favor. How could she be so mean? She wasn't mean, she was nice. What was I thinking I was going to do all day at the mall with a group of girls? Shop for blouses? Give my expert opinion on nail polish color or something. It would have been a disaster. And Sue saved me from that. Is there someone you should speak to? Is there someone in your life you should have a difficult conversation with? Tell them something they don't want to hear? Are you delaying? Are you saying you're going to do it later and putting it off? Don't. Don't hesitate. Do that same favor for that person that was done for me all those years ago. You know, it's funny. I haven't seen or spoken to Sue Schallenberger since we graduated from eighth grade a year later. But I think about her a lot. I remember her fondly. And when I do, I always remember to say, thank you, Sue. Because she's the one that taught me that now is the right time to do the right thing. Mr. Toastmaster.
May we please have 1 minute of silence so the judges can mark their ballots. Our second contestant is James Hammond. The speech title is Say Yes. Say Yes, James Hammond.
There's a story in the Bible about a man who was lame. And he kept coming to a pool in Bethesda for 38 years. He came because there's a story that the angels would swirl the waters and the first person who would get in the waters would be healed. On this particular day, Jesus came, saw the man, and asked him if he wanted to be healed. The man said, yes, but there's no one able to take me to the pool. And Jesus said, do you want to be healed? And the man said, yes. Then get up and take your clothes and start walking. Toastmaster chair, guests, and fellow Toastmasters, there is power in the word yes. If you want to do anything in life, you have to first say yes and do it. If you want a job, you have to say yes, the job is for me, and then you fill out the application and you get it. If you want to be head of a club, director of this organization, you've got to say yes and then take action. If you want to make the great speech, you've got to say yes and get up here and make that speech. Every great person has said yes. George Washington, when they needed a general, said yes. For me, I want to be general. And they said, well, George, if you want to take it. Not only did he become general, he defeated the world's greatest army, the British, and became the first president of these United States. Millions of men had died in the Civil War, and people were saying, we need a new president. But Abraham Lincoln said, no. Me, I want to be president again. And he became president. And the Holy Spirit came to Abe and said, Abe, it's time to free the slaves. And Abe said, yes. And signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And there were those who thought that African Americans could be kept down after slavery. So they murdered people, lynched them, desegregated their facilities, made them live in very difficult situations. And they thought that this system was going to last forever. But there was a man from Atlanta who had a dream. And he said yes to his dream. And he broke down the walls of segregation in this country forever. And there was the man from the south side of Chicago by the name of Barack Obama who said yes and became the 44th president of this United States. Fellow Toastmasters, when I was a young teenager, wanting to go to college, I said yes. My parents had never gotten past the eighth grade. They had no money. We knew nothing about scholarships or grants. In fact, the high school I went to, they didn't take the black kids aside and say, here's the scholarships and grants. In fact, they told us nothing. But I had a dream. I took the entrance examination, passed it, went into the school, took my seat, like I was supposed to be there. Didn't have a dime. But you know what? When you combine yes with action, the doors were open for you. 7 years later, I walked out of that university with my shoulders back and my head up with 2 degrees. And I had been made the president of the Black Student Union. And as a result of that activity, I enabled hundreds of other young people to go through that institution and get their degrees as well. Because I said yes, and I took action. Today, I want each of you to ask yourselves, are you like the lame man sitting by the pool waiting for someone to help you? If you're that person, I want you to know that today is your day to get up and follow your dream. Don't wait any longer. Toastmasters, I want you and you and you this day to get up and follow your dream by saying yes, Mr. Toastmasters.
Thank you, James. Phantom timer, we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Thank you, Madam Timer.
And he sees a man walking towards him. And the man is carrying two buckets. Now, as he gets a little closer, he notices there's something in the buckets. So he asks him, "What do you have there?" The guy says, "I have some lobsters." He said, "Well, where are the lids? Where are the covers? Aren't you afraid they're going to crawl out and get away?" He says, "No, no, no. These are Irish lobsters." The guy says, "Irish lobsters?" He said, "Yeah, when one tries to crawl out, the others just pull them back in." Mr. Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters and guests, do you have some Irish lobsters in your life? Maybe at work? Perhaps in your friend group? Or maybe at home? I'd like everyone to take a quick second here and ask yourself, are you an Irish lobster? Now, I believe we're all going to have some key intersecting points in our life. Maybe it's a career opportunity or an opportunity to meet new people. And I really believe that what we do in those key moments will really dictate where we end up in our life. I had such a moment like that a number of years ago. I was a carpenter working for a construction company. And now this company had 7 or 8 different carpentry crews. And I was one of the newer guys on the lesser crew. I was actually getting coffee for the guys at break. Well, the company announced that they were going to interview carpenters to fill one superintendent position, which would have meant I would have climbed out of the carpenter bucket and into a management bucket. And I was very excited to hear that I was going to be one of the guys interviewing. Now, what was crazy for me to see and watch develop is every other carpenter knew exactly which carpenters were interviewing and when. And those of you in an office, you'll understand this. When someone came back to the job site after they interviewed, you saw it happen. You saw them say, "You don't want that job. You've got to work long hours. You have to deal with people." My own father, who had been a painting contractor for that same company, had seen so many guys come and go in that position. And he said to me, "They will eat you alive." So like most of us when we're a little younger, we ponder some advice from our parents, and it hits home. So I interviewed for the job, and I got it. Now, I believe I worked 5 years for that company, and I got a lot of experience. And then you know what? I branched out on my own. And this year marks my 20th year in business. You see, my biggest fan is my father. Because he saw me put my head above that bucket and try and climb up. And he was only trying to protect me. Well, I believe we're all going to end up in the same spot in life, unfortunately. And all we're going to have to tell our story is a headstone. And that headstone is going to have very little information on it. It's going to have a born date and a died date. And the only thing meant to show what our life was that little dash in between those two dates. Now, I feel that that dash will be most reflective of two things: the chances we took and the impact we made on someone else's life. So if that's all we have to show for our life, do you want that dash to be perfectly polished, just out of the box, never been used? Or do you want that dash to be nicked up and dinged up and twisted and bent? Do you want that dash to have some scars on it, some scuffs, to be tarnished? Do you want that dash to have some peaks and some valleys and some valleys? You want that dash to tell your story. You want that dash to show that you tried for some. I love what Renee said earlier about trying to meet your full potential. Trying to see what your full true potential is in life. Isn't that all we want for our kids? Yeah. For ourselves? Don't we owe that to ourselves?
Yeah.
So you're going to look at that dash, and you want someone to look at your headstone and look at that dash and say, boy, that person lived a life. Do not let anyone in life determine what your true value is in this world. Do not let anyone determine what your true potential is. If you find yourself in a bucket in your life that you don't feel inspired, that you don't dream anymore, that you don't see any sign of hope for yourself, do all you can to reach as high as you can. Clip those claws on the rim of that bucket and get out of that bucket. Get out of that bucket before you kick the bucket. Mr. Contest.
Thank you, Sean. Madam Timer, may we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Thank you, Madam Timer. Our fourth contestant, Bridget Small. I know for certain, Bridget Small.
Toastmaster, I would like to share a little of my story. I
was born in Chicago, the only living child to James and Mary Small. At 2 months old, I went to go live in Virginia with my dear, loving, praying paternal grandmother named Mama. There, she had 15 grandchildren, and I happened to be in that bottom five among four sisters, and they are my sister cousins. First, there's Jackie. She was our boss. But most importantly, she was our helpmate. For every day when we were young, Jackie, help me, Jackie, help me. And she was always right there. Next, there's my cousin Lisa. She was a beauty queen and didn't even know it. Pregnant and sanctified at 16. Then comes Marion. She was always the captain and president of a team. And then come Wah, their sister cousin Bridget, the only child. And next to me is the baby. Her name is Olivia, and she embodied many good things. We all went to the same high school, Forest Glen High School, AKA the Mighty Forest Rangers. And there, they were all honor students, except for me. Oh, how I wanted to be on that honorable wall of fame where their names were embedded, but I didn't achieve it. But not once did my sister cousins ever say, you're more beautiful and smarter than you. They only had good words and grades to share with me and Mama. They were born to be good girls. But I wanted to leave a legacy at Forest Glen High School, where I have spent some of the best years of my life at, surrounded by the most wonderful, kindest, poorest, blissful people in the world went. What would be my legacy? And then one Saturday afternoon, I was watching Soul Train. And I decided I'm gonna become the school's best dancer. It was the only thing I knew how to do good. Once a year, the school held an award for its best, most, and favorite students, only voted by the students, and they were all my best friends. This would be my last chance to be able to bring home to Mama a material achievement. I started the next school day. I saw them peppered on the bus. It's your thing. Do what you wanna do. It's your thing. Do what you wanna do. I did Prince in the hallway. Maybe I'm just my mother. She never satisfied. This is what it sounds like when doves cry. Cindy Lauper. I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. A beautiful like the rainbow. I did the 10 top music videos in 8 weeks. I am the school's best dancer. And then my day came. I'll never forget. It was Principal Smith.
Welcome to Forest Glen High School's best, most, and favorite students, only voted by the students. Bridget Small, you are our best and favorite class clown of our school. We love you, Bridget. Good luck in this world. I was overwhelmed with disappointment. I actually felt like Carrie in her movie. Who are you, people? Who are you?
said, "Don't crack! But I know for certain that God loves babies and for why, Mama? Why? For neither knows better." See, ladies and gentlemen, the moral of my story is that I didn't know any better. I was just a typical teenager. I watched too much tail lies vision. I thought I could make shortcuts in life. This is foolish thinking. But today, I know for certain what's most important, that I wear a good attitude. That's called purpose. Because I had a praying grandmother that prayed to a faithful God for a fool.
Thank you, Bridget. Band timer, may we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their balance. Thank you, Madam Timer. Our fifth contestant, Andrea Kowalski, My Solo Flights. My Solo Flights, Andrea Kowalski.
Not long ago, I found myself standing in a peach grove in a scene that should have been in a movie. The bright summer sun shone down through the leaves, gently warming my face. A smooth breeze blew big puffy clouds overhead, wafting the scent of acres of peaches past me. The thin aluminum handles of an old-fashioned bushel basket cut into the palms of my hands, straining against the pounds of peaches inside. I stood alone in a grove of pure beauty on a flawless day, utterly heartbroken. I was out of tears and had settled on numb. But how did I get there? Mr. Contest Master, fellow Toastmasters, and honored guests, the story starts about a month earlier with a newspaper article. I'm one of the few millennials, you see, who still reads the newspaper. And I found out about a brewery boom in Berrien County, Michigan. I planned an end of the summer trip with my then boyfriend. Before we could go, however, he broke up with me. We never had a major argument before, which is probably pretty telling, because when we did, he ran. It was the worst breakup ever. I was 27. We were talking about getting married. We were getting ready to move in with each other. He was the one person who I could really start to trust. But apparently I wasn't going to make a good enough housewife. In hindsight, I dodged a bullet. At the time, though, I was shattered. I couldn't leave the house for a week. With this trip coming up, I thought to myself, how could I possibly do this? This was an us trip. I can't do it by myself. I can't go. But in an act of rebellion against my own self-thoughts, I decided to go. I could still go exploring, and I had to learn how to be uncomfortable and alone and grow. The adventure started on the road with a call ahead to the first place, was very popular and wanted to make sure I got a table. So I called and the receptionist at Greenbush said, "Table for just one? Are you sure?" That cut deep. I ended up having a good time at Greenbush, though. The food was delicious. And I went on to two more breweries that evening, where I had delights at each one, and started to forget the sting of being alone. Now, for those of you who don't know, a flight is between 4 and 8 small pours of a brewery's beers. Usually they're the ones they like to show off, and it's your chance to try a bunch of different flavors without committing to full glasses of each one. However, if you're going to have flights at 3 breweries in one night, you're going to forget just about anything. The next day, I found myself at a place called Cultivate, where I was sitting on the porch with my flight, watching the hops vines stretch 10, 15 feet in the air towards the rain clouds. When the locals drunkenly thought the solo guitarist next to me was my boyfriend, I corrected them, but the emptiness inside was slightly tempered by a feeling of, well, maybe that's okay. When the rain clouds cleared, I spent Saturday at several different places, exploring small towns, striking up conversations with people on the street, trying more breweries and more flights. The locals back at Greenbush had suggested a place called Lemon Creek Winery, and although it wasn't on my list, as it was a winery, I decided to go. That's where I picked the fresh peaches and even did a wine tasting. Now, every point up to then, I thought to myself, I wish someone was here to share this with me. He should be here. But standing in that peach grove, in that scene that should have been in a movie, I did not let the pangs of loneliness ruin the experience. I even ran into a bachelorette party in the tasting room. And although weddings were the last thing I ever wanted to think about ever again, I felt my skin harden a little bit. I was getting a little tougher. That night, I had another flight and ate from a food truck at a place called Arclight. Now, Arclight was easily my favorite place. They were having their second birthday party that night. And they had the bocce, they had the bags, they had the bonfire, all out on the back patio. I had my flight, and I lost track of time over grapefruit sours with a couple of locals. It was nice to finally stay as long as I wanted, go when I wanted, do whatever I wanted without having to check in with someone. And believe you me, I stayed as long as I wanted. Sunday morning came, and I found myself waiting for a brewery to open in downtown St. Joseph. So I walked down to the beach and stuck my toes in the sand. Now the water was still a little cold, but I felt this strange warmth trickling up from somewhere and settling deep inside. Maybe I was starting to thaw. I had gone from shell-shocked to bitter and numb to thawing out by myself in the course of a weekend. After lunch and the flight at the brewery, I had another winery downtown and started to plan my trip back because I could. So why do I tell this story? Well, it isn't terribly exciting or remarkable. I tell it for the lessons I brought home. One, we all have to be uncomfortable before we can grow. Think of the hermit crab. Not the Irish lobster, the hermit crab. How does a hermit crab know when he needs a bigger shell? Well, he gets so tight and uncomfortable in his hermit shell that he has to venture out, take a risk, and find a bigger one. Traveling alone can be lonely, or we can learn how to be alone and be content with it. And two, if you're going to have flights at 10 breweries on a weekend by yourself, be sure to eat as much as you drink.
Thank you, Andrea. Madam Timer, may we have 1 minute on the clock while the judges mark their ballots. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Timer. Our sixth contestant, Yvonne Bailey. I want more. I want more, Yvonne Bailey.
I want more. That's what my son said to me as I was preparing his dinner plate. I put a heaping spoonful of collard greens on his plate, fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and cornbread. And before I could hand him his plate, he said, "I want more." He always says he wants more when it pertains to food. My son is 5'11". He weighs 129 pounds. He looks like a string bean. I don't know where he puts all the food he eats. But he always says, "I want more." Fellow Toastmasters, honored and distinguished guests, I thought about what my son said. I want more, and it resonated with me. Because I want more, too! When I say I want more, I'm not talking about a bigger house to put things in, or more clothes, or more furniture, or another piece of workout equipment to throw things on top of. What I mean is I want more of the things that make life fulfilling. Some of the things I speak of are intangibles. However, I believe they are attainable. I want more peace. I want stress to roll off my back like water rolls off a duck's back. I want to release from worrying about things. I want to respond to the issues in life in a calm and cool manner, believing no matter what comes, it's going to be all right. I want more joy. I want to embrace each day as if it were a gift, because it is. I want to take the time to spend the time with others, realizing we are creating wonderful memories for tomorrow. I want to be mindful of the temporariness of life. I want to celebrate life. I think by celebrating life and the blessings in life, we may find the joy of life. Like planting a garden and watching it spring forth, or witnessing our child take their very first steps, or learn to tie their shoes by themselves, or celebrating that our 80-year-old mother can still cook a delicious meal and it tastes like Thanksgiving on Sunday. And even though she's getting older, she's still sharp enough that she can advise you how to put out a kitchen fire with flour instead of water so you don't burn down the house. I want more visits with my chiropractor. Specifically Dr. Ed with Chiro 1. That man has healing hands. He was able to assist me with an area in my neck where there was resistance. However, Dr. Ed is very expensive and he does not take HMO. So I can only visit Dr. Ed for a season. I want more time for vacation with my husband and my son. I want to go to Hawaii and other beautiful places that are lined with white sandy beaches and surrounded by clear blue waters where you can see all the way to the bottom. At least so I've heard. I want to go to Paris and see the Eiffel Tower, and then to London to the Stephen Wilshire Gallery, and then to Frankfurt, Germany, where I was born. And I do not want to have to rush back because I have to be at work on Monday morning. Okay. I want more sleep. I want to sleep past 8 a.m. more often because it helps my body recover. I feel stronger, and I look younger. My
ideal of a good night's rest is waking up to my own internal clock and not some blaring alarm clock or some child yelling, "Mom, it's 6 a.m., time to get up." I want more love. I want the love of God to grow in my heart so full that I have to give it away everywhere I go. I want to find the best in others and give the best of myself. I want to forgive quickly and not harbor any resentment in my heart because that would stop the flow of love. I want others to recognize the difference in me as the greatness within. The greatest, most awesome, most wonderful gift is love. Love bears all things, no matter what a storm may bring. Believes all things, no matter how the future seems. Love hopes all things. It never gives up. Love is eternal. It never ends. I read in the book, The Song of Solomon, many waters cannot quench love. The next time someone asks me if I want more, I will tell them. Want peace? More joy? More visits with the chiropractor? More time for vacation? More sleep? More love? Yes, please. I want more.
Yvonne. Madam Timer, may we have 1 minute of silence while the judges mark their ballots. Thank you, Madam Timer. Our final contestant for our International Speech Contest, Bessie Akuamwa, Heart of Ghana, My Heart. Heart of Ghana, My Heart, Bessie Akuamwa.
Good afternoon, fellow Toastmasters and guests. It is my honor and my pleasure to stand before you. I am here to take you to Ghana with me. Ghana is 6,200 miles away, 13 hours by plane. Before we depart, I want you to close your eyes, trust me on this, and think of your happiest memory. You only have a moment. This will be your reserve fuel, just in case you need it on this trip. Okay, open up. We're in Ghana. This is my first trip ever to Ghana, with my husband and my two daughters, December 2009. We have a personal car. The personal car takes me and my family to our first destination, Obo. Obo is far up in the mountains. It looks as though it's going to touch the clouds. I want you to join me once more. Imagine that you're lying on your bed. You're in a forest preserve, but there are mountains in this forest preserve. Imagine what you see. Maybe you see flowers, you see the tall trees. Whatever it is that you saw, whatever it is that you imagined, I saw it and experienced it 10 times more. Because this home that we went to was built by my husband's father and his two brothers. A giant home carved into the side of a mountain. Amazing. I entered that home. The stairwell is 12 feet wide. It reminded me of an up-to-down staircase, a school that I attended. And I yelled out, "Hey, we can open up a girls' school." And the voice came back, "No, children, sound. They're too far away. They won't come to the school." "That's okay. We can do a boarding school. I know we can do this." "That's not going to work." And I'm like, "Ugh." And I'm thinking, how can I take this house, these trees, and even the sky and the river with fish back to the United States with me? And all of a sudden, I'm thinking, my heart was filled with greed, absolute greed. We left Obo, and as we traveled and came closer to Accra, we saw some children building a house out of sticks, simple old sticks. And we were amazed, and we said, "These are the architects of the future in Ghana." And we were really proud. My heart was proud of these little children. The next day, we had a different destination. That destination was the Gold Coast. The Gold Coast is so named because of the gold that was found there in the 15th century. It's located on the banks of the Atlantic Ocean. Also, the slave castles. That was our true destination to visit. In the slave castles, this is where hundreds of thousands of slaves were housed until they were shipped off to the Americas. Above the door of the slave castle, it said, "No return." Once the slaves entered, that was their death and their doom. We entered the slave castles, and I'm here to tell you, they're not castles. They're dungeons, pure dungeons. There were images engraved on the side of the cave and on the floor. This was to let us know that these people, the slaves, were piled on top of each other when they slept. There was no place to walk. There was no space at all. There was no toiletry outings. They had to defecate and urinate where they slept and where they ate. Made my heart sad, so sad to see this. I journeyed further with my family, and guess what? The slave merchants actually did have a better housing, well-lit facilities, even a parquet floor. They had beds to sleep in. They didn't sleep in those beds alone. They slept in those beds with the slaves that they raped. They raped those slaves. And I became angry. I was so angry that this happened to those women, children, and probably even the men. I was angry. We went further, and there was a sign that talked about a British captain who died of a venereal disease. A venereal disease. Are you surprised? I'm not surprised. And I was glad, really glad, that this guy died from a venereal disease. And someone actually said to me, "Didn't you pity him? Pity?" I'm sorry. There was no pity then. There's no pity now. No. We exited the slave castle. President Obama visited there in July of 2009. And he had inscribed, "Never again, never again." My heart was filled with hope that this would never happen again. We traveled home to Accra. Upon entering the courtyard of where we lived, our home,
Everything was dark and dismal. I said, what is going on? This is Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve, there should be some excitement and activity. And we went into the home, and I was soon to find out that my father, of 87 years, died earlier that day of a heart attack. I wanted to scream. I felt screams in my head, but there was nothing audible. Nothing came out. I just asked, why didn't they tell me earlier? And then I realized they knew that I would have tried to go to the airport. I felt like a prisoner. Everything was locked in. My husband, being the person that he is, served us wine. And we talked about my father. And as Sean said, it was a lot going on with my dad. The next day we went to the courtyard, and I made fufu with the women who were gathered there to give me happiness. And I pounded the fufu. And I was content. My heart was content. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Bessie. Madam Timer, the judges now have as much time as they need to complete their ballots. I would like to ask the audience to please remain silent while the judges do complete their ballots. Sometimes even our Toastmasters get confused, and you ask what their education level is, and they might say that they've got an MBA, or they might say they've been homeschooled. We're interested in what level of education you reach in Toastmasters.
I'm a homeschool Toastmaster. I'm an advanced communicator silver and an advanced leader bronze.
All right.
Very good. How long have you been with Toastmasters?
10 years, I think. Sue? Yeah. 10 years, thank you. I can never remember. I have to ask somebody in my club. 10 years. But I like to say, I'm proud of the fact that I was at the very first demonstration meeting in my club.
Oh.
And so.
I'm looking here at your interest and hobby, and I see history and science. I'm just wondering, no longer interested in the opposite sex?
Did you outgrow that fascination? No, just one member of the opposite sex. One. She's not here, but I'm still saying it in case she has spies in the room.
So how do you, what do you do for your, as a hobby or interest, history and science? How do you, what do you do for that?
Well, I like to read history books because it tells us what happened in the past and we can learn from that. And I also like to absorb as much science as I can, like on Nova or any TV show or any article, because that tells us what's going to happen in the future. So like the dichotomy between those two.
All right, and I can't let this go. Your favorite quote is, you've got a head like a rubber boot.
Yeah. That was something my father used to say when we got in trouble. Come here! You got a head like a rubber boot! Pay attention. He also used to say, if you trip, open your skinny eyes. Or you make a better door than a window. He always had a funny thing to say. I was standing in front of the TV and was trying to watch Manny. Get out of the way! You make a better door than a window. But it was all said with love and compassion, but you got a head like a rubber boot. He said it to me a few times, and people around us burst out laughing. So I think about that, I remember my father.
Okay. Very good. Kathy, thank you so much. James Hammonds, would you tell us which club you represent?
Saturday Sunrise, and there's my president over there.
Education in Toastmasters?
I have an advanced communicator bronze and ALB,
advanced leader bronze. Very good.
CL, that's the one.
Okay, competent.
Thank you.
Competent leader. Still very good.
I don't want to be like Trump and tell you all.
Growing up, I had a great coach when I was about 12 years old, I'm 51 now. He coached me 3 months of my life at 12 and taught me to never quit. And I still keep in contact with him. And I always said, he made such an impact on my life, that I said, if I'm going to raise my hand and coach different people and different things, I owe them that effort. So that really kind of the ultimate pay it forward for me is coaching and trying to, again, like Renee said, get someone to see their true potential.
A Les Brown quote that's your favorite. It's better to prepare for an opportunity you don't have than to have an opportunity you're not prepared for.
Yes. I think that's the Toastmaster quote.
Yes.
I mean, we're all preparing for, when we go to meetings, you're trying to improve, and if we get that out, all of a sudden opportunities come up where someone asks you to talk. I had that happen where a nephew of mine is graduating from Bradley University in construction management. I've been in construction for 33 years, and he asked me to come down and speak to about 70 graduating kids. So I knew how to prepare a speech, I practiced it at a meeting, and I went down and I gave that speech. I didn't join Toastmasters to be able to do that, but little did I know I was preparing for an opportunity I didn't even have. So when it came up, I was prepared.
Bridget Small, will you tell us what club you represent?
I represent Christ Universal Temple, 666-595.
Your educational level?
Smarter than a fifth grader.
I love it.
Do you have your CC?
No, I haven't.
Wow! At some of our contestants that just come out of nowhere and with very little Toastmasters experience behind them can give such a great dynamic speech. Outstanding.
Woo!
Very good. Good for you. So how long have you been with her?
I've been with Toastmaster almost a year. It'll be a year and we'll be approaching April and May.
Okay, well, very good. I like this. What inspires you most? Happiness, smile of a child.
Yes. For me, happy is not about me or you. It's about we. Because happiness is nothing if we don't share that in together.
Amen.
A child's smile reminds you of innerness. It's inner happiness. Happiness is not on the outside. It's on the inside. So when you see a child smile, that comes from his or her spirit. And that's also when it comes to adults, too. Your happy is always in the inside of you. So we all should strive for our own happy, and we share it together as we.
Yes.
Would you be so kind as to share your favorite quote with our audience?
One of my favorite quotes come from Martin Luther King from the Drum Major Instinct speech. And the message that I received from that speech was, everyone wants to win the game. Everyone wants to be first. Everyone wants to be a champion. All in useless things, just to brag and boast and put down others. But who wants to be first in love and kindness and peace, moral excellence and generosity? Hard to find folks that wants to be first and become champions in these things.
Club.
Just
earn my CC, I'm going toward my ACL.
And how long have you been with Toastmasters?
Just a little over 3 years now.
Very good. We have so many hobbies and interests. Just tell me about your favorite.
Oh, that's hard to decide. Besides traveling and trying new beers, I recently, in the last few years, picked up running. And if you saw me 10 or 15 years ago, you would say that is not a run. But I found that it kills my stress. It keeps me in shape. It keeps me traveling. I actually worked up to running the Chicago Marathon a couple of years ago. Okay.
I do like this quote of yours. You cannot educate a child who isn't healthy, and you cannot keep a child healthy who isn't educated. Explain that.
That's right, that comes from, I think it's M. Jocelyn Elders, one of the former Surgeon Generals, and she was talking about the need for health education in schools. Just like physical education, sometimes health education isn't often mandatory or daily in schools, but one of my certifications is I'm a health teacher, a PE teacher, and right now I work with special needs children at the high school level. And it's so evident to me that the kids come in the classroom, if they haven't had breakfast, they're not going to absorb anything you throw at them. So they're not healthy, so they cannot be educated. And if they're not educated on what they need to do to keep themselves healthy, they're not going to be healthy. So it's a symbiotic relationship that I hope more and more people start to recognize and start to include in that institution of education.
Very good. Participating in today's contest.
Thank you so much.
Yvonne Bailey.
Yes.
What club do you represent?
Park 4, 1717.
Even animals save food for the winter. Why is that your favorite quote?
It's my favorite quote because my father said it to me. Alan Sultan, when I was 17 years old, I had a job with Sears. I was earning $2.50 an hour, and I could work 20 hours a week. But I'm spending the money as quickly as I got it. And my dad said that to me, meaning you need to put some money away.
My favorite part of the contest, where I call up our division director, who will eventually announce our contestant winners. Please welcome South Division Director Jerome Rowley.
Before we present the awards, I want to have our district leadership give any announcements that they would like. Can I speak to is either Gwynn here or Cassandra Lee? Oh, Cassandra, there it is.
Make sure that everyone realizes that this is a Toastmasters year, and every one of you guys should be striving to get an educational level. When, before I got my DTMs, every Toastmaster year I said, what's the next step? What are the next 10 speeches I need to do to go farther? When I was in school, in college, seemed like it's a long, to get that degree seems so difficult. But once you got that one degree, the second one came faster. And the third one, taking a little bit longer time, but a master's degree takes, when you're working, it takes a little bit longer. But the second one, Dr. Rogers, the world is changing. We need to be able to communicate with our bosses to tell them what we're doing so that we can get those raises. And get those opportunities when they come. A lot of opportunities knock on your door, and they come in and shrinking. The opportunities are shrinking. So you've got to be aware of those opportunities. But we're going to give you an opportunity to win a gift. Okay, the first number, 821. 821?
821.
What is our first number? Last number, sorry. Last number. Next number. The last three digits, 807. All right. Man, he got tired.
I saw my
friend
looking
at
you. Yeah, so my
friend don't write to a gift. 835. 835.
All right.
Okay, 822. Eight three three.
They're gone.
833.
They're gone.
Hey, great choice.
They're gone. Dig deep.
792. 792.
Hallelujah.
792.
Right here.
And the last gift. Eight, four, seven.
You got one more prize to award, Ivory.
847.
Hold on. Mr. Ivory, you got one more prize to award. A personal visit from me to a Toastmasters club, whoever wins this round. Pull a number. Pull a number.
Tim, repeat what you said.
I'm coming to your club to tape a meeting and perhaps to maybe personally coach a couple of your members via the video camera.
So in other words, that means the members of that club get a chance to see what they look like on camera.
Yes.
They get a chance to have an evaluation process, possibly where the club can have it as an open evaluation for the club.
That's correct.
Okay.
That's two.
All right. We're conferring.
Okay.
All right. District approved. It's district approved. All right.
Okay, before I read this, I always pray,
before you do anything, let the district know before you do it in advance. It helps a lot.
841.
Angela Mustin. Today is going to be competing at the district speech contest, which will be at the spring conference, and that will be Friday, April 28th for the tabletop contest. So I hope you can all go there to see Angela on stage. Now we're going to switch to the international speech contest.
Woo!
Again, starting for the third place winner of the South Division International Speech Contest is Yvonne Bailey. And for those people who did not walk away with the trophy, know that you are still winners in my heart, because I know that to go through this, you went through a growth process and you won something from it. So everybody comes home for this a winner today. So thank you all. The contest is adjourned.